because something's going to happen. A crisis is developing. Now, let's read this together. Five manuscript, page 305. Let's read together. It says, and what's that next word? Do you know anybody from India? Is anybody watching on the internet from India? Now, my brother and sister, you better understand something. It says, in India, what else? China, what else? Russia, what else? And this disease of, now, you better understand something. Do you know that every one of these countries we're about to talk about is in the news right now? Storm just went through India, north side of India, just recently. They said it was a freakish storm just before the monsoons, and people's lives lost. The world needs to understand what this means. It says, in India, China, Russia. Now, what has just happened? Who has just been visited in the countries? Where was President Trump just going to? And what powers were coming together? Do you know that North Korea, South Korea, China, all through the news? But we don't know what it means. Russia. He's being tested right now. Probe if there's any connection between President Trump and Russia. We see these things, but because we have lost our identity, we don't know what it means. It says, in India, China, Russia, and the cities of America, thousands of men and women are dying of what? Is this true? Yes or no? It says, the money men, because they have the power, control the... This money is very significant in this prophecy. It says they purchase at low rates, they can at the lowest rates all they can obtain, and then sell at greatly increases prices. This means, what's that next word? Starvation to the poorer classes. And will result in a what? Now, does it say has resulted, is resulting, or will result? What tense is that? Pastor. Now, I want to write this on the board. I want to come over here on the board. I'm going to write on the board. I'm going to put up here one. I'm going to put up here two. I'm going to put up here civil war. Because the prophet says that this will result in a what? What's that next word? In a what? Do you believe the prophet? Yes or no? It says it will result in a civil war. Now, my brothers and sisters, we know there's going to be a war of classes. It's going to be a civil war of classes. Now, this is a civil war. Now, question. Historically, in America, was there a civil war, yes or no? Does anybody know when the civil war was? Now, if you asked me many, many years ago, I couldn't have told you because I didn't study history. I hated history. But you want to find out, brothers and sisters, if you hate history, you hate your identity. A man can't understand his identity without understanding history. We're going to understand that in a little bit. Now, my brothers and sisters, civil war, question. What years was the civil war in America? I see your hand. Talk to me. Thank you, sister. 1861. Now, she was paying attention during class. Praise the Lord. This is 1861 through 1865. This is the historical civil war in America. Are you with me? All right. Keep that on the desktop. Let's continue. It says, and will result in civil war, there will be a what? A time of trouble such as what? Now notice, right after the prophet says this civil war takes place that she's talking about, right after she says civil war, I'm going to write down here, you'll know why in a minute. Right after she says civil war, then she says there's going to be a time of what? I'm going to put T-O-T. Now that doesn't mean time. You know what T-O-T stands for? Time of trouble. Okay, now watch. Now question, did the prophet prophesy of this historical civil war? Did she prophesy that? Yes, she did. She was alive. You know, the prophet was alive in 1861, you remember? She didn't die until 1915. The prophet, if you read the testimony, volume one, she talked about in the church that she was in. She said, there are young men that are alive today that are going to die in the Civil War. She talked about it. Now, my brother says, between the North and the South, she talked about it. She was alive. She warned against it. She talked about why, and in fact, Civil War was God punishing America for slavery. There's a whole chapter on this in the writings. Now, my brothers and sisters, once you understand that history, you see that, then I'm going to answer a question. Was the prophet here speaking of this civil war, yes or no? No. Now, someone says, how do you know? Now, look at this. What year is this? What? I can't hear you. What year is this? So now, in 1899, the prophet says it not has resulted in a civil war. The prophet says what? So what tense is that? That's future. So the prophet says, after 1899, we will see a civil war, not in the past, but we will see a civil war in the... Now, my young men in the back on the sound, we're going to have to be focused right now. Everybody here needs to understand we're in crisis. Amen? Amen. Now, my brothers and sisters, this says that there's going to be a civil war not only in the past, but there's going to be a civil war in the future. Now, after 1899, there will be a civil war. That means that there will be a prophetic civil war. Somebody said, you didn't even tell me that a civil war can take place. I'm going to tell you something. We're getting ready to see it. Now, do you know another name for civil war? Anybody know what another name for civil war is? There's another name. In one word, another name for civil war is what? You know that right now in America, revolution is getting ready to start. Now, if you start getting on the internet, do you know that right now today, even those who are not seven minutes will tell you that a civil war is about to take place? Those that don't know anything about the Bible and the prophecies, they will tell you, brothers and sisters, that a revolution is brewing and developing, and the only ones that don't know are Seventh-day Adventists. We're coming to church careless, indifferent. God is trying to say, please, whatever you do, you better do very quickly. And we're going to show you, brothers and sisters, that we don't have much time. Now, Satan knows that there's only one denomination that can put all these pieces together. You know what the name of that denomination is? Talk to me. What's the name of that denomination? Now, we have maybe two or three Seventh Adventists here. I heard another. I can't hear the rest of it. That's all right. Listen, you will never be a part of the loud cry whispering. Now, when did the Seventh Adventist Church historically get established? What year? So 1863, the Seventh Adventist Church was organized, given a name, given a message. Now, my brothers and sisters, that was in the middle of the what? Of the first what? Now, in the first Civil War, the Seventh Adventist Church was not finishing its work. The Seventh Adventist Church was doing what? In the first Civil War, the Seventh Adventist Church was beginning its work. Is that right? That's history. Now, my brothers and sisters, now, if that's what's happening in the first Civil War, what do you think is going to happen with the Seventh Adventist Church in the last Civil War? Talk to me. In this last part, the Seventh Adventist Church is going to do what? Finish the work. Now, my brothers and sisters, what I'm going to show you today and tomorrow is that in 2018, you are in our eye in this time, but in order to finish his work, we've got to understand our true identity. And the devil knows, I'm telling you something, the devil's afraid. The devil is afraid that if Seventh-day Adventists understand their identity, our identity, that his head is in trouble. Do you understand what I'm telling you? Satan's very existence is at stake because every other denomination believes the war is over. Every other church believes the war is over. And the sad thing is that Seventh Adventists who've lost our identity, you can come to many of us and we too will tell you that it all finished at the cross in 31 AD. Am I right or wrong? But now, my brothers and sisters, listen. In order to understand what this message really is, we've got to go back to history. And the devil's plan, he says, I've got to enslave the Seventh Adventist Church. I've got to do what? Someone says, no, Seventh Adventist Church can't be in slavery. No, impossible. You know, the Jewish nation said the same thing when Christ came to the earth. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They said, free? We have never been in bondage to any man. In other words, we have never been in slavery. What do you, they struck their chest out, pow! We have never been in slavery. What are you talking about, enslaved? Jesus said, look, you are a slave right now, and your lifestyle shows you. Do you know, brothers and sisters, right now today, that if a husband and wife are fussing and fighting, they're slaves right now. They're enslaved. They're enslaved to evil tempers and evil appetites. You know right now that if a husband and wife are fighting over divorce, in slavery. But brothers and sisters, if parents and children cannot get along in the home, they're enslaved. If a man can't control his eyes so he doesn't watch pornography. If a man can't control his eyes so he doesn't watch women coming into the church. If a man can't control his tongue or his hand or his mind or his lips, he's enslaved, do you understand? My brothers and sisters, today, we have a bunch of Seventh Adventists, all of us, in slavery. And God says, I've got to make you free if you want to finish this work. And in order to enslave a man, all you've got to do is study history. In order to enslave a man, it's going to take more than guns and tanks. It takes more than force to enslave a man. You know, you can never fully enslave a man just by enforcing slavery. You know, in the songwriter wrote a song. You remember the song, Faith of Our Fathers, Holy Faith? You remember that song? No, you don't remember that song. See, we stopped singing hymns a long time ago. Is that right? We lost it. What did the song say? It says, faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till. It says, our fathers chained in prisons dark, were still in heart and conscience what? Free. It says they were in prison, but still they were free. You see, that guns and tanks, force can't completely enslave a man. In order to enslave a man, you got to do more than enslave his body. You got to enslave the man's mind. And so if you study history, any form of slavery that has succeeded because the captor has taken control of the mind of the captive. And by taking control of the mind, you have to get control of someone's education. Am I right or wrong? You see, a slave, it was unlawful for a slave to read or to write, because the moment that the slave becomes educated, that man's mind wakes up and he can no longer be enslaved. And so the devil's plan is to enslave the Seventh-day Adventist Church, because we're the only ones that have a message that can destroy this kingdom. And the devil says, I've got to enslave them. All you have to do is the history. Was Daniel enslaved? Yes or no? What was the first thing that they did to enslave his mind, his education? They destroyed his history. They destroyed his heritage. They destroyed his culture. They destroyed his tongue. They destroyed his language. And all of it was to destroy his identity. That's all. Do you remember that when he went down to Babylon, they gave him, not he didn't talk in Hebrew tongue. They said, you have to talk in the tongue of the what? Chaldean. Change his language. Anytime you have a power that has colonized another power, they don't let you speak in your own language. They make you speak in the language of the captor. Am I right or wrong? This is slavery. Now, my brothers and sisters, you know that today there are Seventh-day Adventists that no longer know the tongue of Seventh-day Adventists. If we start speaking Seventh-day Adventist lingo today, you wouldn't even know what it meant. We're in a generation today that have made it. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. In fact, when you go back to Daniel, their heritage and their history, what were the names of Daniel's three friends? What were their names? Talk to me. Do you remember? What were their names? Somebody said, Shadrach, Meshach, and no! That was not their name. That was their Babylonian name that destroyed their distinctive identities. Their real names was what? Ananias, Mishael, Azariah. Some said Azariah, I didn't even know that was a name. It's because we've lost our minds. Now, my brothers and sisters, what about Azariah? That was her real name? What was her real name? Manasseh. You see, any time that you study history and you find slavery, whether in the Bible or in secular history, you will find that the distinctive identity of the one enslaved, in order to enslave a man's mind, you have to destroy that mind of the man to believe that he even exists. You have to make him think he's not even a man. You have to make him hate himself. And once that man hates himself, then you can control him. I'm going to tell you something today. Satan has made Seventh-day Adventists hate themselves. You see, there was a race, generation, where people were taught to hate their distinctive identities of their color of their skin, the color, the texture of their hair, the shape of their nose, the shape of their lips, the shape of their life. But as Seventh-day Adventists, it's not just a racial thing. As Seventh-day Adventists, is a religious hatred. So that today, we have Seventh-day Adventists that if it even sounds like Seventh-day Adventists, we hate it. If it's a Seventh-day Adventist diet, we hate it. If it's a Seventh-day Adventist dress, we hate it. If it's Seventh-day Adventist music, we hate it. If it's Seventh-day Adventist education, we hate it. If it's Seventh-day Adventist healing, we hate it. If it's Seventh-day Adventist message, we hate it. We have been taught to hate ourselves. And the greatest hatred today is not teaching a man to hate another man. It's teaching a man to hate himself. What made you hate yourself as a Seventh-day Adventist? Why don't you know your history? Why don't you know your heritage? Why don't you know your roots? Why don't you know your distinctive identity? Why have you let the devil steal your identity and you say nothing about it right here in Silver Springs, Maryland, right next to the General Council? Why is it? I'm going to tell you something. Listen to me. When John the Baptist prepared the way for the first coming of Christ, John could never have done it unless he understood his identity. Did you hear what I said? Look at John. Let me show you that from the Bible. Look at John chapter 1. John, the first chapter, is in John chapter 1. You remember the work of John was to prepare the people for the first coming of Jesus. And we know that John is a representative of those who will prepare the way not only for the first coming of Christ, but those who will prepare the way for the second coming of Jesus Christ. The Bible says in John chapter 1, beginning in verse 19, let's read together. Father, please anoint your words. We've opened it. In Jesus' name, amen. John chapter 1, verse 19, let's read together. The Bible says, and this is the record of what? Of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites, now when they said, what was talk to me? What was Jerusalem to the Jewish nation? Was Jerusalem some little outskirt town in the middle of an offshoot area? Where was Jerusalem?